For the longest time, I wanted to make an Evangelion video. It's like any tube, rite of passage. But it's Father's Day, so you know we had to do a companion to our first attempt at an essay. And then we got a little ambitious. Eva is one of our favorite anime of all time, and has played a huge role in our understanding of our own issues. Eva is such a self-reflective work, we know that a lot of folks have done the same. I know this because we've seen a lot of YouTube content analyzing it. So much so that if one had, say, a special interest, then there's a lot of material to sift through. And through that, and our recent digestion of the show prepping for the last Rebuild movie that was supposed to come out this month, before the plague, we've come to a new understanding of it as it relates to Shinji and his father Gendo. So here we are. Punkbite, can I please do the summary? Can I do the summary, please? Summary?
Yes.
Can I do the summary? Infantabite, you can do the summary. Go ahead. Neon Genesis Evangelion is about a queer kid named Shinji Ikari, who starts working for his father's secret organization, NERV, tasked with saving the world from destruction from a series of mostly kaiju-esque creatures called the Angels. The world is barely hospitable to humans because of climate change. The second impact, which was caused by humans experimenting on their ancestral cousin, Adam. Think Adam and Eve, except as aliens and there's no Eve, and humans come from Lilith, best girl. It wiped out most of humanity, made water levels rise around the world, and sparked global nuclear conflict. Holy shit. But the government covered it up, saying it was just a meteorite. NERV has these super special weapons, which are a result of Adam experimentation, called Evangelions, or Evas for short. No other weapon is effective against the Angels. Shinji has abandonment issues. His mom died when he was really, really young, so her soul can inhabit Shinji's Eva. Not that he knows that until later. Evas all have human souls in them. It's kind of how they're made. Well, at first. The best pilot for an Eva will be the kid of the person whose soul inhabits it. Oh, and for some reason, only children can pilot them? Shinji starts off not having seen his deadbeat dad in several years, but gets a call to adventure from him. He's apprehensive about piloting the Eva and working for his dad. But let's just say Gendo is very persuasive. And Shinji is very insecure. Shinji's dad is manipulative and distant. Not just from his son, but from like, everyone? He only cares about one person, his wife. You know, the one that's a giant, otherworldly mech? Yeah, it's a whole thing. So, throughout the series, Gendo is playing a 3D chess match with essentially the Illuminati over who gets to control the future of the human race. Which if Gendo has a choice, he'll let all die so he can be with Yui forever. Oh, and the pieces are his subordinates. Shinji makes connections with a number of folks throughout the series, other Eva pilots, his classmates, and his de facto guardian Misato, who has very similar abandonment issues and abuse issues, but self-medicates and puts on a happy face to cope. In fact, all the major characters have something going on that makes human connection nearly impossible. A very strong theme for Eva, represented by the Hedgehog's Dilemma.
Do you know the fable, The Hedgehog's Dilemma?
Hedgehog? You mean those animals with the spiny hair?
Even though a hedgehog may want to become close with another hedgehog, the closer they get, the more they injure each other with their spines. It's the same with some humans. The reason he seems so withdrawn is because he's afraid of being hurt.
Shinji has unconventional character development, as he doesn't really get better throughout the series like one might expect. He's more relatable than many protagonists in media because his experiences don't necessarily make him stronger or more resilient. Constant near-death experiences, alienation, and depersonalization are all the order of the day for Shinji. Piloting the Eva is trauma-inducing. He does it at first from a sense of duty, but later settles into doing it for praise, specifically from his father. But Shinji white-knuckles it for longer than anyone expected, other than maybe Gendo. Shinji goes in circles for most of the series. He goes back and forth between piloting the Eva and swearing off it forever, but can't stay away for long because he has no value outside of NERV. Well, I know that's kind of a fucked up thing to say, but once he starts building connections all related to his duties as an Eva pilot, he'll lose his whole support system on top of the things he does for validation if he quits, which the series weirdly never acknowledges. Anyway, Shinji does everything he thinks he's supposed to do to make those around him happy. Of those that give a shit, they always end up being disappointed though. As the series wraps up, Shinji's relationships are severed, or rather, his access to validation through them is severed. One of his classmates becomes an Ava pilot, but because the Ava turns out to be an angel in disguise, Shinji's forced to kill it, almost killing his friend, and he's forced to do it by his father who had a failsafe put into the Ava in such an event that Shinji wouldn't want to kill someone. His first pilot friend, Rei, ends up sacrificing herself to save Shinji, and although she is a clone and is replaced, she doesn't remember Shinji, essentially wiping his save data. His first love interest and rival, Asuka, loses all reason for living and isolates herself after a series of traumatic events makes her unable to pilot an Ava. Feeling alone herself, Masato, Shinji's guardian, offers him sex, which he rejects and decides he no longer wants to live with her, which is hella understandable. During this time, he meets his new love interest, Karu, who connects with Shinji quickly and gives him something to look forward to again. Except, oops, Karu's the last angel, and in a historic anime moment, Shinji kills him so the human race can live, proving he's at least not as selfish as Gendo. The last few episodes of the series are an experimental film about Shinji trying to self-actualize, and are pretty optimistic but do leave many questions unanswered. So, fans of the time were disappointed and sent through creator and studio death threats. Ah, things never change. So with all the dissatisfaction, Hideki Anno made the sequel movie, End of Eva. In it, Shinji is depressed enough to read as suicidal for most of it, and only really exerts agency at the end, when the human race has all their AT fields broken so they all become an emotional matrix of connection and happiness. It's called instrumentality, and it will be on the test. In the end, Gendo, who wanted to control instrumentality, is denied entry, let alone control. Because, plot twist, Rei, who's part of the trigger for it, sees him as the shitty person that he is. Because Shinji left a good impression on her through the last Rei by making her feel like a person, and not a doll. But everyone does turn into goo still. But the human race can come back if they, like Shinji, ever want out of the literal existential hedonistic cuddle puddle. The biggest change in Shinji is that he wants to try to live after all this. We could have just stayed in eternal bliss. He rejects perpetual validation and accepts that only he can assign himself value and will face pain and failure again, as all humans do. Then there's this last scene that's highly debated after he and Asuka reject instrumentality and end up on Infantabite, but I'll be covering that part.
I'm not used to being liked, but I'm quite familiar with hatred.
We remember first seeing Ava and feeling Gendo might heel turn and end up having kept Shinji at a distance for good reason. Having come fresh off a bunch of horror and psychological anime thinking that, oh, Gendo's hiding a horrible secret, maybe he's protecting Shinji somehow. Turns out, not only was I so fudging wrong that I should have been covered in ice cream, but also, he's on brand from the very beginning. He did have secrets, of course, terrible secrets, but they don't make him justified. The lesson of his shittiness was that he was just like Shinji. But worse? And that fact keeps me up at night, to be honest. Because not only were we projecting a hope for a justification of Gendo's behavior, because we projected on Shinji and wanted in our real life or our abusers to have a good reason for treating us like they did. To add insult to injury, we kept distance from someone we care about because we saw them as too similar to us. We thought that contact with us would only hurt them. Watching Ava recently and hearing Gendo say,
"When Shinji is near me, all I ever do is cause him pain. I thought it was better when I did nothing at all."
Were you afraid of Shinji?
I didn't believe that anyone could love me. I never deserved to be loved.
So you were running away. And you rejected the others around you. So there was no chance you would ever be hurt.
May us feel like we're more concerned with protecting ourselves in the end. And that our own self-hate pushed us away because the similarities scared us into thinking we'd hate them too. Maybe Gendo didn't think exactly like that, but he definitely wanted to spare himself pain. Many a video essayist has waxed poetic about the nature of Gendo being a worst-case scenario of how Shinji could be. But it really rocked me recently because of a particular analysis of Ava.
"For doing this and for causing the most intense suffering of all to those who drew close to him, he's just the worst case scenario of Shinji, who until End of Eva was actively trying to form connections."
And you know, we like metaphors here, folks, so if we're talking human connection and Gendo putting up walls against everyone is a tenet of his character, and he's not allowed to participate in the ultimate connectedness of instrumentality because of his behavior, then I think that's a sign that maybe Hideaki Anno wants you to evaluate if you're putting up walls, if you're protecting yourself so much that you're protecting yourself from everything, not just the pain of rejection or abuse. Maybe in that effort to not feel pain, you are inadvertently causing yourself pain. You can go around other folks a regular pre-corona amount and still feel alone every day. Gendo sits on high of Central Command and is physically distant from every one of his colleagues except Furuyutsuki, who knows of his true vulnerability. In a way, he's enabling Gendo. He's the only one who can really call him out, and that really doesn't amount to much. And that's likely only because their relationship started off with Gendo as his student. Not to mention, no one in NERV really knows Gendo before he put up his walls. Or at least not very well. Furuyutsuki is Gendo's last reminder of the person he was. Gendo's position of power is what elevates him above his subordinates. And he hides behind it. Just like he hides behind those hands. Those hands we used to think were always hiding a knowing smirk. Like the trope of a master anime tactician. But he's hiding everything. That's why he wears the sunglasses too. The less of them you can read, the better. We know this firsthand, as it's a strategy to appear less fragile. We've done it too. Maybe not the sunglasses everywhere, but hiding your face? Forcing a neutral expression? Or just in general trying not to seem as emotional as we were? That was and still is a strategy we have with dealing with hard conversations. It's like a Yu-Gi-Oh trade. If the person knows you want a thing really badly, then they don't have to offer something of equal value because you're trading from an emotional place. If you've been pegged as a sensitive person, especially as a kid, people will often not be kind to you, or at the very least, make you painfully aware of your shortcomings in handling it. Society expects a baseline resilience in disappointment and unfairness. Depending on your identity and privilege, the baseline might be higher or lower, but if you have the means, a sensitive person can inflate their self-esteem enough that from a distance, no one can tell the difference between being actually well-regulated. Gendo's position, not just physically, but as the head of NERV, is very much a barrier for connection, which is funny because otherwise his tools for being distant wouldn't be enough to obfuscate all of his pain.
Yes! That's got to be it! He abandoned me because he already had Ayanami!
As if you didn't already run away yourself.
I really connect with Gendo? Especially at this point in our life, and it does not feel good. But I don't think that the jump from Shinji to Gendo is a very wide one. Many folks to this day identify with Shinji, self included, especially queer folk, and it feels endearing at times, but whenever we look at analysis of Eva, we're reminded of the fact that Anno is sending a message with Shinji. Shinji should be learned from, not idolized. If I had to compare him to a character in another work, I would actually go for Bojack Horseman, someone who it's a little more obvious that he's not intended to be someone the audience wants to be like. I feel that the Bojack childhood scenes and those while he's getting his feet wet with comedy are some of the most endearing of the series, and if a series followed Bojack in his younger years, when he was outwardly more sensitive and didn't have fame or immense wealth to hide behind, we'd think he'd be very much uwu softboy territory in his fandom. So is the difference between Shinji and Gendo just having power over others? Well, no. But it's a big factor. Keep in mind, Gendo largely does what he wants. And damn the consequences. While Shinji is doing things out of obligation or a desire for validation. And when he's not acting out of those places, he tends to do terrible or dangerous things. Shinji's inability to emotionally regulate himself or find contentment is really endearing to the audience. Well, at least the ones who aren't yelling at him about getting in the damn robot. I don't think this dynamic is exclusive for queer folks in growing up, but unfortunately it's hella common. Knowing that your future will surely deviate from what's expected in society, let alone your parents, can instill a feeling of never being good enough, though not for lack of trying. For that reason, it really sucks that Shinji is such an important figure to a lot of folks in the way that he is. If you see yourself like Shinji, then you're likely going to want him to get the human connection and self-fulfillment he craves, just like you might want that for yourself. But the unfortunate part is, when he gets those things, even momentarily or superficially, it never works out. And it's not only because of Nerve or his father. Getting what he wants without any internal change will only end up hurting him or the people around him. And although Shinji is a victim of abuse, that does not excuse the fucked up things he's done. And as someone who struggles with mental illness, we know not everything a person does is completely up to them. But unfortunately, if you suffer and are hurting, and you hurt someone else, the pain you inflicted isn't just an oops. You're entitled to forgiveness, and not everyone is going to give you leniency on the grounds of mental illness or trauma. In fact, the world kind of disproportionately punishes people who have mental illness or trauma when they do bad things, as opposed to giving them support. The world isn't fair is flung around a lot, especially by entitled folks who've made it, or bitter folks who think you're too soft. But we think the world isn't fair is better used as a warning. As a minority, the truth of an unfair world is starkly obvious, and if you're lucky enough to find community, then you might get some help managing that disappointment or help to mitigate the hardships. And Shinji never really gets a consistent feeling of community. And this is where we see another big difference in Gendo and Shinji. Shinji mostly finds fulfillment through attachment and fawning.
Value! I want to be worth something! I want to be worth enough to attract the attention of others!
So, we mentioned before how Gendo has these walls up and doesn't really let folks in, and that Futoyutsuki is only privy to the real Gendo because he knew him before he put up those walls. Now, I figure a number of y'all might have wondered why we didn't mention Yui or even Rei at least, but I don't think either of them are reminders of his old self. Rei is someone Gendo can project Yui onto, but is ultimately a tool for seeing Yui again, just like the rest of Nerve. Unfortunately, with the amount we see Yui in the anime, we don't get to see how the relationship dynamic actually played out, but here's a guess. Yui was for Gendo what Karu was for Shinji. Someone who, at least as far as Gendo and Shinji are concerned, loved them unconditionally. I didn't like the line change of Karu in the Netflix dub, obviously, but I think it's accidentally a really telling line.
Their hearts are delicate like glass, yours especially.
You think so?
Yes, you're worthy of my grace.
I propose that regardless of what Karu says in this scene, you're worthy of my grace is very much how Shinji would feel in relation to Karu and how Gendo feels in relation to Yui. See, the line irks me not just because of queer erasure, but because it makes Karu an abusive dick to have said it. Someone who is as low as Shinji in this part of the series would probably take any love or positive attention he was given. And this, now infamous line, is the equivalent of someone having read your mind and used your greatest insecurity to wrap you around their finger. Shinji wouldn't think he's deserving of love. After all, he's trying to prove his value to others throughout the series. For the record, I don't think Yui did a similar thing to Gendo, but the thing about folks like him and Shinji is, when you live without thick skin or emotional resilience, and even basic disappointment hurts you immensely, finding someone who values you and gives you anything even seeming like unconditional love and acceptance is like a gift from the heavens. And since self-esteem is lacking and human connection is hard, because of the good old hedgehog's dilemma, it's easy in that position to attach yourself to that person and elevate them. To see them not as a porcupine, but a pillow. They'd be God in your eyes. And if you're like us, this is when the waterworks start. When you only find value through others, this tends to happen. And what may feel like luck in finding a person who makes you feel so valuable may be a climb before a mighty fall. In Shinji's case, Karu's death was crushing, especially since he killed him, and he didn't feel like he had a choice. But in Gendo's case, he didn't really lose Yui, at least not from his perspective. He's just not seeing her for a while before he gets to be with her forever. Now, because of the limits of fiction and Eva canon, we can't see how these characters might be in a world without angels. Except yes we can, because Eva apparently has an exhaustive list of alternate timelines. but the one we care about right now is the one in episode 25 of the series, where Shinji, Gendo, and Yui all live together as a family. Shinji seems normal, whatever that means, but Gendo is still hiding his face. It's just with a newspaper this time. So often have we seen this scene and wondered why the hell he needs to cover his face still. Or rather, why Ano chose to have him cover his face still. Well, keeping that motif in mind of hiding one's self away from others to shield one from pain, it's kind of obvious, isn't it? Gendo hasn't changed. He still needs to protect himself. But he doesn't have nerve or his position to hide behind. But Yui is still in his life. He likely still only values her and still feels Shinji and him are too much alike for them not to hurt each other. So he hides from everyone but Yui. But this isn't the world of Evas and Angels, so there's no huge threat to all their lives. Shinji would probably grow up in this reality with a father that's there physically but not emotionally. And, like real life, probably wouldn't understand how this affected him till later in life. Emotional trauma and neglect can do that to you. Gendo's stoicism would probably just be seen as him being a man, and he'd never need to own up for his behavior for that reason. Maybe not even if Yui left him. I think Gendo's basically the same in both realities, because even the illusion of Yui is enough to keep him going. If Gendo lost her completely, then he'd be as inconsolable as Shinji following Karu's death. The truth is, Gendo is codependent on Yui, and Shinji is codependent but can't maintain his relationships. What does that remind me of?
If I trust their words, it's enough. Enough to keep me alive.
It's sometimes hard to admit for us, but we struggle with codependency a lot. And oh my gosh, can we say from experience that having someone you feel so lucky and graced to have in your life versus not being too attached to anyone are like two completely different evolutions, but with the same weakness. Being cute as hell, sorry, that both have a lack of self-worth, and that can still lead to hurting others. So Gendo having the one source of value means no one else is important to him. He doesn't desire any more connections, or to improve the ones he has. Even in a world where he can't have direct contact with Yui, and any action he takes is justified in the pursuit of being with Yui. So his mentality is entirely based on selfishness and his own eventual toxic hedonism. If he had been in control of instrumentality, he wouldn't have given a shit about anything but Yui. Human race? Fuck 'em. Which is totally relatable, especially when you've lived a life of constant pain and only trust your favorite person. But very few people on this earth have the power to hurt all of humanity. I mean, there's not that many, right? So Shinji can do a lot of harm like Gendo, but he's not exactly like Gendo. He wants to make connections even though he struggles with them and fulfillment. A plus to Shinji is that he also happens to care about people in general, to some extent. I mean, he does get an Eva Unit 1 at the beginning of the series because he doesn't want Rei to have to do it. It's obligation, but more like, I can't let this happen, as opposed to, I will be rewarded for doing this. Which is a huge difference. Not that he doesn't eventually come to understand he keeps doing it to get approval from his father, but that first time, he did it for someone else. But that's also the problem. Shinji may want his dad's approval, but he does cite others as why he feels the obligation.
Don't worry, I'll pilot it.
But you don't want to do it.
Of course not. It's not something that comes to me naturally. But Ayanami and you and Miss Rizzo...
Stow that line of crap! This has nothing to do with any of us!
Namely, Rei and Masato. And of course he feels this way. Rei not only becomes someone he wants to keep from harm, but also someone who on two occasions explicitly protected him. Even if the first time, she was only doing it because of her mission. And Masato put a lot of effort into trying to connect with Shinji. Even if she was doing it mostly for her own sake. Though now that I think about it, she saw herself in Shinji and probably wanted to do for him what no one could really do for her when she was younger. So she might just be projecting. Though, if so, that's definitely not the worst thing Masato has ever done. But that's for another video. And they did grow closer, but she had her guard up a lot too. Instead of covering up with stoicism, like Gendo, she did it with happiness and bombast. Raise your hands, little bites, if you've ever done this. We know we did. Not happy? Just force it. What could go wrong? Shinji doesn't leverage his position as an Ava pilot for any power dynamics, at least as far as we can see. But his desire for validation does hurt folks. If Shinji thinks piloting an Ava will get him praise, and he knows it's for the good of humanity, then he definitely knows Nerv will be handicapped being down a pilot at the very least. He knows what's at stake every time he runs away from piloting. He knows what he's risking. And when he decides to fight the penultimate angel, as much of his decision at the time is framed as his personal growth moment, his finally deciding what he wants moment, it's kind of undercut by the emergency-ness of the situation, isn't it? We always feel weird with Ava as metaphor because if it's symbolism for adulthood and deciding to do what you think needs to be done for you and not for others, then the fact that all human life will die feels dramatically at odds with that reading. Even if you come from the perspective that when you're a teenager, everything feels like the end of the world. Though nowadays, I feel like we're in the middle of the second impact anyway. So, in the end, it feels like it's not Shinji's decision. It's obligation again. He still wants value. And if he doesn't do it, everyone would die. Including him. So, it's kinda everyone's damned if he don't. And he's damned if he do. With all that said, Shinji doesn't seem that bad, right? It's not like Gendo using people as tools and not giving a shit about the human race. Well, no. But Shinji did enact instrumentality, masturbate over a comatose Asuka, and try to cave in Central Dogma to get revenge against his father for making him hurt his classmate.
Unit 1 has 185 seconds of power left. That's enough to destroy at least half of headquarters.
My father! Tried to kill Toji, and he did it using my hands!
All really shitty things, and even if we throw out instrumentality, because no human can actually conceptualize the entire human race, then we still have attempted murder and sexual assault. Oh, and some extra attempted murder on the side. So, these actions are pretty important to most analysis of Ava. Any one by itself can be a money shot. We've come to realize all these actions come from the same place, though. A place we didn't realize till something was pointed out in the first episode of Ava. That also comes from this place. If you haven't guessed yet, then let us tell you. It's Shinji's immense fear of rejection. Now, the letter fits in because obviously, when he was summoned by his father, he ripped it up. But he decided to put it back together. Shinji was very literally abandoned by Gendo, so this is an overwhelmingly understandable response. But I mean, he hadn't heard from his dad in years. If something had changed, then maybe he'd be valuable to him again. Maybe he'd get love. So he taped it back together. He ran away by ripping it up, and he ran back by putting it back together. As he does throughout the series. Even once he tries to destroy Central Dogma, he later still pilots the Ava and kills Karu. And it's because he still can. If he has the option to try to get value, to earn praise again, then he will. That's Shinji's pattern. We even see it in the sandcastle he builds and destroys all over again, during the scene of instrumentality. He can't see the value in himself or his accomplishments without the praise of others. He self-sabotages, but he always tries again, and not in the inspirational way. Shinji feels rejected by Asuka even though she's incapable of doing anything for anyone at that moment, or even well before. But he still needs to get something from her. So he squeezes out a little bit of good stuff to make the bad stuff go down easier. And he knows it was a terrible thing to do. He chokes Asuka in the final scene because she rejected him the last time by not being conscious. So even though he had well reason to be happy, she was even alive considering his reaction to her dismember Ava right before instrumentality, not to mention him choking her during instrumentality for refusing to validate him, even there. So, he tries to destroy the sandcastle again. I mean the letter. Oh shit, I mean Asuka. If she can't exist for him, then why should she exist at all? She can't reject him if she's dead. And why does he stop? Because she stroked him. Just that small kindness was all it took. If feelings of rejection are massive in Shinji, just imagine the little bit of praise he needs to get by. I mean, Gendo just needs to be sure he'll see Yui again one day, but Shinji gets told he's top sync rate one time and immediately becomes so arrogant he becomes irresponsible. Now I know if you really identify with Shinji, then maybe this was kind of fudging hard to hear. Shit, I didn't even want to type it. But without self-awareness, we can all make the same mistakes. And I don't mean turning everyone into Tang. The beauty of fiction is Shinji will never have to be held accountable for his action. Well, maybe. But who knows, you know? But I do know that simply getting the validation he wants will only perpetuate his dangerous cycle. We haven't done things nearly as bad as Shinji, but we have been on that cycle. He reminds us of a BPD sufferer. He reminds us of us. Of wanting so badly to hold on to those good things that feel like they never stay. Of being so afraid of rejection that self-sabotage and rejecting others before they can reject you sounds like an amazing alternative to trying. Of trying so hard to please others, you lose track of your own desires. Of defining yourself through how other people see you. Of feeling safe in a state of being emotionally numb, is that's better than feeling everything on full volume. If Shinji can't pilot the Ava anymore, then he'll be in a very dangerous place, similar to how Asuka gets when she can't pilot anymore. All that inflated self-worth goes right out the window. Even she ends up in an Ava again after completely giving up. And I'd imagine it's for roughly the same reason. Maybe, just maybe, she can find worth again. If she gets another chance, then she has to go through with it, right? Hi, and Fantified again. Some may find it hard to see characters as having mental illnesses, especially when doing so might lead them to question their own mental health. But that's a good thing, even if you don't end up having the thing you thought you did. You'll have done some good self-examination. Mental health representation is important too. It was amazing seeing someone at least as dysfunctional as us try to save the world, or even just save the city that day. It's hard to internalize, but helping even one person is an amazing feat. Shinji has done harm, but he's helped too. The creator, Hidetaki Anno, has talked about his own poor mental health before and during Ava's production. In fact, for that and many other reasons, Anno was writing episodes barely ahead of production, week to week. It's almost like being a YouTuber. Knowing that breaks the illusion that everyone doing art professionally has all their poop together. Seeing a reflection of yourself in media can give you an outside perspective on yourself. A perspective folks who know you personally might be too biased to provide. Many folks find out they're trans or depressed or otherwise ignorant to a part of themselves through the stuff they like. Especially anime. I'm gonna spoil the end of the second and the entire third rebuild movies in a minute, so be warned, and you should be able to skip to this time to avoid it. The rebuild movies are an AU of increasingly divergent events from OG Ava, and are numbered with decimals for some reason. 3.0 occurs in a world where Shinji triggers the third impact. Well, sorta. It was stopped in the second movie by Karu wielding the Spear of Longinus, a spiffy spear that neutralizes all Adam-related beings, including Ava's. In the third film, Shinji wakes up after being in Unit 1 for years and is weirdly the same age. Masato and the principal Cass are at war with Nerve, having realized Gendo is basically a supervillain. Shinji begs to be able to pilot an Ava to help, but is denied and told he's not needed. Asuka and a new pilot have it under control, but everyone also knows Shinji can restart the third impact if he pilots again. So they give him a Suicide Squad collar that will detonate if he tries to restart it. He's rescued and taken back to Nerve by a clone of Rei that has no positive feelings or memories of him, and though he tries to connect, she has nothing to give. No internal life. No desire to connect. Gendo is somehow even worse. His obsession has grown, and he has no subordinates that would care about his motives, so he can be openly scummy now as well. Of course, when offered the chance to pilot an Ava, Shinji fucking does it. Despite the contentious warnings of ending the world and a bomb collar on his freaking neck, After all, he has nothing else. But that's not before meeting Karu in this reality and making a connection. And Karu, the sweet, sweet boy that this world does not deserve, takes Shinji's collar and puts it on himself. So Shinji won't be so scared of piloting. They pilot an Ava made for two people. Couples Ava. Karu also doesn't want the third impact to happen.
We should turn around, Shinji. I've got a bad feeling about this.
You can't be serious, Karu!
And wants to subvert their orders from Gendo. Shinji just does what he's told before Karu can even figure out how to not fuck everything up. Shinji accidentally pulls the trigger on the third impact, and in doing so, gets Karu killed, which this time is all on him. And just like in OG Ava, he's given up on life after this, and is dragged along by Asuka this time instead of Misato. We don't know if Shinji will be redeemed in the last rebuild, but we do know he's willing to disregard the advice of everyone who cares about him if it means he can attempt to fill his emptiness. There's a level of self-hate that makes one disregard how their actions affect others, and that can be a very dangerous kind of person. Even when someone goes above and beyond to validate him, they will eventually get hurt. Shinji is being carried by the tides of his emotions, and he's not fighting back.
I hate myself, but maybe I could love myself.
Shinji has the potential to not be destructive, but it's not something he can accomplish by simply knowing his problem. It's only the first step. This is why the experimental film of OG Ava, episodes 24 and 25, don't count as growth to us. We've had moments like that too. You say to yourself, this is my turning point. But then you still end up back where you started, back on your own bullshit. Shinji only has the epiphany he needs to change, and knows how that might look. But the effort and follow-through it takes to improve will be rigorous. Using the example of BPD again, it's actually quite common to give up on improvement. So much so that those who've had close relationships with those with BPD often say, do these people even want to change? And it's not that that person wouldn't be happier managing their issues, but that the process can seem downright Sisyphean. Especially because any setback or disappointment is still cranked up to max volume emotionally. I think inspirational themes and media can fool a person into thinking they will already be on the road to change. We know we did. We saw 24 and 25 and thought, this message is something we need to take to heart. This is important to us. And years later, return to it in hard times. You can fool yourself into thinking you've made more progress than you have. And so weirdly, we're glad that Anno made End of Ava, because otherwise Shinji would probably be remembered as overcoming his issues in the end. And I think that that would have led more people who identify with Shinji to think like he did with his self-improvement, because when a story ends, it's easy to think, oh, they're gonna be okay now. Stories typically end up with the protagonist winning, and it's even sweeter after seeing a character struggle for so long. And Shinji is definitely a high-tier sufferer. As an audience, we want to see him stabilize at least, and as someone going through some of the same things, you'd want to see him be okay, because it gives you hope that you might be okay too. We are not saying hate Shinji. That would probably be counterproductive if you feel akin to him, and we wouldn't even be able to follow that advice either. But even if Shinji won't ever become so much like Gendo, that doesn't mean he's innocent. Gendo is so far down the rabbit hole, and has the privilege of power that he can hurt folks on a massive scale without ever piloting an Ava. He has a lack of compassion for others and only wants to protect himself and be validated eternally. Shinji can't hold on to the objects of his validation, but the desperation it causes brings him to make terrible decisions, including hurting those he claims to value. Shinji's shittiness is more unpredictable than Gendo's shittiness, because Shinji is often reacting impulsively. I guess it's the difference between premeditated murder and a crime of passion. Ava is very much a cautionary tale. Anno seems to want to tell folks not to retreat into escapism, not to give up on human connection, and not to rely on outside sources of validation and worth. Given what he said about his own work, it seems he was trying to tell himself that too, just like we're trying to tell ourselves with this video. He wants you to step out of the ACL. What are you laughing at, Infantibite? You said ACL, not LCL. ACL is a muscle. Can I finish? Yes, Infantibite, you can finish.
Yay!
He wants you to step out of the LCLC. And like Shinji, face the pain that other people bring when they get close. Even if it's gonna be a long road to accepting oneself. Taking responsibility. And not running away. We believe in you. Take care of yourself. Hey, Punkbite, do you think I could host an episode myself one day?
Well, the sky's the limit, little one. I don't see why not.
Thank you all wonderful little and big bites alike out there for waiting on our video. We are a day late now, so it's not technically Father's Day, but we really appreciate your support and 1K subscribers. We're really excited to keep making awesome analysis videos for you. But we're just starting to get the hang of anime analysis, so let us know how we did in the comments. And if you want to support the passionate work we do, we now have a Patreon. All patrons get their name in the credits of our Sunday vids. I think that's about it. See y'all in the next video.